Hello and welcome. Today we're going to introduce to you the basics of cell culture and demonstrate how to process your cell cultures in this lab. One of the most important precautions of cell culture work is to prevent contamination of your cells. To achieve this, we use cell culture hood like this to provide a sterile working environment by using a filtered air circulation system. There are different cell culture vessels that you can choose from based upon your experimental needs. This is a cell culture flask with a vent cap to allow gas exchange. Now here's the culture dish, which comes with a lid. In this experiment, we're going to use this culture dish. We usually grow cells in 37-degree carbon dioxide incubators like this to maintain optimal temperature, moisture, and pH for the cells. The cells we will use in this lab is called PC12. PC12 is an established cell line initially derived from a rat neural endocrine tumor. It is an excellent tool to study cell signaling events triggered by growth factor like EGF, which we will use in this lab. So now let's open the incubator and take out our PC12 cells. The pink liquid inside the cell culture is the growth medium, which provides the nutrients such as glucose and amino acids to the cells. Now let's take a look at these cells under the microscope. As you can see, PC12 cells are small in size and sort of have an irregular shape. It's also worth noting that these cells adhere to the bottom of the culture dish. Cells like these are called adherent cells. To culture adherent cells like the PC12 cells, we need to use culture vessels treated with materials to generate a hydrophilic surface to which cells attach and grow. Now you've seen the cells look good. Let's begin the experiment. For cell culture work that requires extensive handling and longer incubation, we should use a cell culture hood. But for this experiment, since your cells will be harvested and lysed immediately after the 5-minute treatment, you can just do the experiment on your bench. At the beginning of the lab, each group will receive 2 dishes of PC12 cells. You will treat one with EGF for 5 minutes, and the other one receives no treatment. Based upon the information provided on your lab menu, you should calculate how much EGF you need to treat the cells before coming to the lab, and you should also write down your answer on the lab menu. Before the treatment, be sure to label on the lids of the culture dishes with your table number and sample names, such as UT for untreated and EGF for the treated sample. After pipetting up the EGF solution, check to make sure there's a liquid in your tip, as you will pipette a very small volume. When adding solutions into the culture dish, pipette against the inner wall of the dish. At the same time, make sure the tip goes into the media but does not touch the cells on the bottom of the dish. By adding solutions this way, we can minimize detaching the cells from the surface of the dish too early in the experiment. After EGF is added, swirl the dish gently to mix up the solutions, then immediately return both dishes back into the incubator and incubate there for 5 minutes. While the cells are incubating, label 2 2-milliliter screw-top microfuge tubes the same way as you label the culture dishes. These tubes will be used to collect cell suspensions and lyse the cells later. After the incubation is complete, take out your dishes from the incubator and return to your bench. For simplicity, the rest of the video will only demonstrate how to process one sample. But in the lab, you will work with your partners to process both samples. Gently pour off the medium into the liquid waste container on your bench. You should notice the cells remain attached to the bottom of the dish. Then wash the cells in each dish with 5 milliliters of TBS to remove the remaining media proteins that potentially affect your Western blot results. To do the wash, simply pipette 10 milliliters of TBS into a 10 mL serological pipette. dispense 5 milliliters into one dish and the remaining into the other dish. Again, remember to pipette slowly against the inner wall of the culture dish without touching the bottom to avoid detaching the cells. Pour off TBS into the waste container. Be careful not to mix up the lids of the dishes. Immediately pipette 1 milliliters of TBS into each dish and scrape off the cells using a sterile cell scraper. To make it easier to collect the cells, slightly tilt the dish and scrape all the cells into the bottom corner. And pipette all the cell suspensions into the pre-labeled 2 mm screw-top tube. Pipette an additional 500 microliters of TBS into each dish to recover the remaining cells in the dish. Again, tilt your dish and rinse off the cells to the bottom corner. Then pipette all the cells into the 2 mm tube containing the first 1 mm cell suspension. Remember to use a new scraper for each dish. After cells are collected from both dishes, centrifuge both tubes for 3 minutes to pellet down the cells. After the centrifugation is complete, check to make sure there's a white cell pellet at the bottom of the tube. Use a P1000 to remove as much supernatant as possible without disturbing the cell pellet. The final step of processing your cells is to lyse the cells in a sample buffer called Laemmli Buffer. This buffer contains the detergent SDS that can dissolve the cell membrane and denature the proteins in your samples. It also contains the bromophenol blue, a blue dye that is used to track the progress of electrophoresis, which you will perform later in this lab. As Laemmli Buffer is very toxic and smelly, be sure to wear safety goggles and gloves when handling this buffer. And keep the tubes containing Laemmli Buffer capped when not in use. Use a P200 to pipette 200 microliters of Laemmli Buffer carefully into each tube. Vortex the tube until there's no visible clumps left in the tube. Incubate the tubes on a 100-degree heat block for 5 minutes to ensure complete cell lysis and protein denaturation. After the incubation, carefully take out your tubes and briefly spin tubes to collect the drops. Now your tubes contain the total proteins from the PC12 cells. The next step is to perform a type of electrophoresis called SDS page to separate the proteins based upon their sizes. Then transfer and immobilize the proteins onto a cellulose membrane. In week 2 of this lab, you will perform Western blot with the membrane to detect the levels of a protein called AKT. So your results is going to tell you whether EGF activates cell signaling through PI3K AKT pathway. Thanks for watching the video. See you in the lab.